Hello everyone, welcome to a brand new episode of the DCKAP's Driven Podcast. I'm really excited today because we're going to be talking to a friend. We have with us Muliadi Jeo, an entrepreneur, serial entrepreneur, I would say, the co-founder of iCube, and then he sold his company or merged his company with Sirclo, and now the chief technology officer of Sirclo. Muliadi is a big name in the e-commerce industry, especially in Indonesia. So Muliadi, we are very excited to be chatting with you, and thanks for joining DCKAP's Driven Podcast. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Karthik. It's always my pleasure to chat with you. It's always great.
Thank you, Muliadi. Before we get started, you are the Chief Technology Officer of Sirclo. So why don't you tell us a little bit about what Sirclo is and what do you guys do as a company and what is your mission?
Sure, sure. Sirclo is a startup company in Indonesia. I don't know if we qualify to call ourselves a startup anymore because we already this is our 11 years now this year as a company. But it started as a e-commerce platform company. The founder, my colleague CEO, Brian, created the company for creating something like Shopify-like e-commerce platform for Indonesia. And then now the company basically evolved. Currently, our main focus really, we call ourselves omni-channel enabler. What does that mean is really we helping brands and principals, multi-Indonesia brands, or even international brands as well, to do business online in Indonesia. And we help them end-to-end from the merchandising, the customer service, all the way down to the fulfillment. We have warehouses so we can ship the items for them to the end customer. So it's the end-to-end services that we provide in every channel possible online for the brands. And at the other side of the company, which is part of my company before, which is we're still doing the technology implementation for brands and principal if they want to go omni-channel and invest in the e-commerce. So that part of the business still continue within Sirclo. So the client have both choices, whether when they engage with us in full service or technology only at this point.
Very interesting. So you do both e-commerce platform with Sirclo. You provide an e-commerce platform for merchants or businesses in Indonesia. And then you also provide technology services through your company, iCube, which is now merged with Sirclo. So tell us about the Indonesian market. I'm very curious. I've been there a few times. Thanks for inviting me. I've really enjoyed my time in Jakarta. And tell us about the Indonesian market. Yeah.
It's very vibrant. I think one thing about Indonesia, and it's generally true most of the Southeast Asia, like Indonesia, Vietnam, Philippines, it's a very driven by young populations, right? I think compared to any other region, we have the most millennial, Gen Y, Gen Z populations in the country. That's why we see that a lot of them creating a lot of the adoption technology very fast. Like, for example, we skip over the entire computer era. Everybody jumps straight to the mobile phone, which that's reflect as well in the e-commerce. I would say still very early in the e-commerce compared to maybe United States and much more mature. But obviously the pandemic last times create accelerations on building a lot of the ecosystem around. So people much more are receiving e-commerce well. And I think the last survey already showed that the customers are already take advantage of the e-commerce to bring convenience and all this access despite of the Indonesia with the archipelago, and which is very, very difficult to ship things from one place to another.
And you grew up in Indonesia and then you also moved to the US. How was it like growing up in Indonesia? Can you tell us about your early years in Indonesia?
Yeah, I'm kind of probably on the odd case. I travel a lot even during my young age. I'm born in Indonesia. I stayed until I was grade 3 and I have a chance to move and have an education in Hong Kong 4 years and then coming back. But yeah, and then I went to the States. I lived in the States for 16 years and before I came back again in 2010 with my family. It's just a culture shock. Even though I'm born here in Indonesia, for us, after living abroad so long in the States for 16 years, I mean, coming back here is like learning all together again. Because, I mean, there's this always cultural. I mean, the nice thing about here, obviously, with a lot of the Asian country, very family-oriented, it's very close to each other, just warm in general. But there's a lot of things that we have to kind of learning the way the bureaucracy thinks and things is not as accessible. like in the States where we whatever you want to find, it's always there, right? But in here, it's, you just have to find your way and basically relearn a lot of those culture things again in Indonesia.
So when you were 3 years old, you moved to Hong Kong. And how long did you live in Hong Kong for?
Actually, I was 8 years old. I was primary grade three. I was in Hong Kong for 4 years. So I graduated primary school in Hong Kong and coming back to Indonesia for the secondary school.
And then after you finished your secondary school and you moved to the US?
Yeah, I went to US for the college and the university. I graduated in 94 from Cal State Fullerton. And I just, and then lived there since then until I came back to Indonesia.
I'm not going to ask how old you are, but then.
It probably shows from my gray hair. Yeah. But yes, this year I'm 48 already. So yeah, up there.
That's awesome, Muliadi. I mean, I'm very interested to learn a little more about your travel because I've seen you travel the world and I vividly remember meeting you. I think I've seen you a few times, but when we had a conversation, I think it was in Australia, in Sydney, where we were crossing the signal. You know, there was a street and, you know, there was a signal and we were crossing the signal and you and your wife, Uni, were there and we just had a conversation. It was really awesome to know you and, you know, starting to learn about iCube and all that. And you started this company, right? iCube with your wife. Can you tell us about the early years of iCube? How did you end up starting iCube and how did you get on to an entrepreneurial journey?
Yeah, it's kind of been a very long journey. I started iCube with my wife actually way back when we were still in Los Angeles at that time in US. It's just a spur of moment, we will say. We bring a few of gadgets. I love gadgets. So, and Asia has been very, I mean, famous for all the unique stuff, like from the electronic gadgets from Japan and stuff. So we bring a few of them back in the States and then we see, maybe I'll try to sell it. We actually go to a lot of the trade fair in the States, bringing all those devices and try to introduce. So that's how we start iCube. As a retail online, I built the website myself, the first learning about e-commerce. Building our own e-commerce, I mean, from scratch. And then we import a lot of those laptops from Japan and we sell it into government agency, even American company like Sony. They bought from us because they don't have access to these Japanese items, even though it's also coming from Sony Japan. And then we also supply a few into the Europe market. So we did that probably about 3 years until we finally, because just the industry itself, they changed Japanese company that's no longer creating all these unique devices all become a commodity and then a netbooks comes up. So everything's so commoditized at that time. So we stopped doing that, but really learned a lot about the e-commerce. That's how we actually start learning about e-commerce. Then obviously I take a pause. I move into an agency in Marina Del Rey. That's where I actually get a lot of the experience of the e-commerce and working with Magento, knowing a lot of the early days of the Magento teams. So with that skill and that experience at that time, we have, it's a family reason we have to go back to Indonesia. So obviously then using that experience and using that connection, we only planning to go here for a very short period. We never think that we're going to be living like this. Actually, my wife's always teasing me that say, hey, I thought we're going to do only 2 years in Indonesia. Then now we end up 13 years, almost 14 years now actually living here. Originally we just planned to create like a remote development team, right? When I back in Marina Del Rey at the company called Guidance, I managed a lot of the offshore, I mean, with India, with Argentina, with Vietnam. So it's been very much my day-to-day job to manage a lot of this offshore team. So originally I'm thinking like creating a team in Indonesia as part of the bigger Guidance project. But yeah, I think fate calling us differently, I would say it's blessing in disguise. Indonesia just starting up with a lot of the e-commerce at that time. That's 2012. We see that this opportunity that we can bring Magento as a potential platform that can be really promote and very useful to a lot of the merchants in Indonesia. Got a few project calling me to, I was living in Bali at that time. So it never in my mind going to Jakarta and working for Indonesia. So So I was enjoying my life in Bali for 2 years when we moved back. But then, yes, and then projects start rolling in Jakarta. A lot of the starting big company investing in e-commerce. We were just in the right time, the right moment. We built the teams very small. The time is probably about 7-8 of us. But we do quite a few, a big project in Jakarta and start introducing Magento more and then building the ecosystem slowly, like with the payment partner and stuff like that. So yeah, that's just like how it started. It's like we never plan out, but me and my wife just do it, I guess, when we're here. And that's iCube was born that way.
Very interesting. But then in the US, you make money in dollars. And then when you come to Indonesia, it's rupiah. How is that? Obviously, you charge your customers a lot more. And how do you get used to that?
Yeah. I mean, definitely it's a big change, right? I mean, here, I'm always joking, right? Indonesia, we do project 1/10 of the value, whatever we can do in US. Obviously, we have to adjust, I mean, the way to perceive the project and stuff like that to what is a value in Indonesia. E-commerce is still starting, so we make sure we deliver a good quality and focusing on bringing a Magento project to retail clients in at that times. So yeah, but obviously, yeah, I mean, we adjusting ourselves to Indonesia and obviously focusing on that more on local and charging on local market.
Yeah, a lot of people may not know, iCube was a remote first company. Even prior to COVID, you had people, lots of people working from their homes and working from different locations. And then you merged your company with Sirclo. How did that process come about? And also after the merger, is Sirclo also a remote first company? Or how do you ensure that the cultures are aligned?
Yes, that's very good questions. We were designed for remote because as I mentioned that we started as a remote developer for US, right? I mean, a lot of the US projects. So everybody had to work late night. I was like working at 11 at night until 7 a.m. in the morning every day for the first 2 years I was in Indonesia. And my team is also doing the same thing. So there's really no point of having an office. It doesn't make sense. So we all work from home. We adopt a lot of the culture, the tools that we've been using in guidance to make sure the teams can communicate really well remotely wherever we are. So that culture has continued to be brought until when we were only a few of us, until when we hit like 150 people at that time. So that's the same culture that we continue to keep remote first. And even we teaching our clients to adopt that. A lot of the enterprise client doesn't like that. They want face-to-face, but our team never in the big city. It's not in Jakarta. So naturally, every project, we force our client to accept us as a remote team from them. But then, yeah, I mean, the merger happened. I will say the timing worked really well for us because we didn't plan it that way. We have the merger conversations in December 2019. We actually finalized a lot of the commercial around early 2020, January, February. And then pandemic happened. Right. So there's like really no choice for Sirclo to change that. And they have to adopt and have to learn from our remote culture. So we end up bringing a lot of our tool, a lot of our culture, a lot of the way that we work into Sirclo, which at that time before the merging, Sirclo is really work from office, everybody in the office, very strict. So we actually bring the influence and then that's how we're able to survive it. So in the pandemic, the culture comes in from us and it stayed. Now after the pandemic, they see that it works, right? I mean, obviously we have to be selective. A certain division has to go to office. Obviously we have like the fulfillment warehouse, which completely have to be worked in a warehouse. But most of the like the tech team, even some of the account teams, they don't have to be in the office every day. That just doesn't make sense. We see the value that we can still, everybody can still deliver whatever need to be delivered in this culture with the right, make sure we keep the culture with the right tools and everybody being accountable to each other.
So the pandemic did help or made things easier for you. So that's very interesting.
Yes,
yeah. It definitely. Your wife, Yuni, is a big part of your success. Where did you meet her or how did you guys get to know each other? I'm just curious.
We are one of the couple that actually meet in the internet, even though we are from the same high school, right? She is like 2 years below me in high school. But we never really get acquaintance to each other, I mean, during that time. So until I study in US and she study in Australia, so we are very far apart. And then we meet again through the alumni.net website. It's very casually. We email each other. I think in that era, everybody have the GSN GeoCities websites. You remember personal websites. So we promote ourselves from their website. We talk from there and then we get acquaintance again. And yeah. And then until she graduated from school in Australia, I brought her to the States and then we married afterwards.
That's amazing. And how was it like working with your wife? A lot of people have this question. Hey, you know, I mean, you work together as co-founders or you work in the same company and then you meet your spouse at home as well. What are some of the pros and cons with that?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, I will start with the cons first. The con is like we really have to know the limit. I mean, because like, you will get carried away that every conversation is 24/7. We will talking about business all the time, right? So that's the consequences that we work together. So we just have to be really balancing ourselves, making sure that we have to be able to stop, okay, working. And now let's don't talk about work. And that's happened a lot 24/7. We just, because not only that we work together, we are the business owner. So it's just in our mind, it's continue to drive us that way, right? The conversations thing, it's nonstop, even really right now. So, but the good thing is obviously then, since we are living together and we know each other very well, and it's just a lot of, so we're able to find the rhythm. It's like, okay, what I'm good at, what she's good at. And then we divide our responsibility that way. Like in before Sirclo, she's always been the one that taking care of everything's operational, internal and stuff like that, right? From how to manage the employee, all the legal stuff, the finance stuff, all the things that I usually don't like. I like more meeting people, going out, building business, the business development, sales, and meeting clients and stuff like that. So I'm more the external one, she's more the internal one. So we define the job quite well when we run the company together.
And let's say you have a bad day at work. Does that reflect at home? What is the dynamic like?
Well, yes, obviously, that's where the break has to come in, right? When we have to stop, okay, have to separate, okay, this is a work discussion, let's not carry over, we have to take a break. But it happens. I mean, even though I think it's happened for any couples, right? I mean, it doesn't have to be working together. But in working together, obviously, we have to create that separation clear.
Excellent. You know, get the boundaries right.
Yes, this is work and this is personal. Let's not combine that.
One thing I really love about the work you do, Muliadi, is the events you put together in Indonesia. It's one of its kind, and for anybody looking to explore Indonesia, at least for people like us, when we think of e-commerce or when we think of Magento, I would say now even e-commerce, you know, we think about Muliadi Jeo. Hey, let's go ask him, what is it like to do business in Indonesia? And you put together great events. One thing I really love is you also invite your competitors to the events and you compete, but you also partner. How's it like, you know, to partner and compete at the same time? You know, a lot of people have this question and I think you do a great job at that.
Oh, thank you. I think it's, I learned this from the European, all our friends in Europe, right? They create this Meet Magento initially, and I learned a lot from them how they really able to have an events where everybody there are competitors and ecosystems. And that's what make Magento so wonderful as far as community. So I take that, and when I went back to Indonesia, when we see the opportunity to actually grow Magento, there's not many people that really know Magento. There's probably a few developers or there's a handful, maybe two or three larger corporations that are actually using Magento. But I think what we feel like, okay, to be a platform to be success, right? I mean, to handle this market this big, I mean, there's always work for everybody. I think the most important one is really establishing a very, very healthy ecosystem. When all the players are able to bring the ecosystem up, it's a win-win for everyone at that point, right? Because then merchants feel like, oh, I will be investing to a platform that has a lot of support rather than just a platform that only wants support or none, right? So that's really the key, the idea. That's why I asked to license the Meet Magento events and bring it to Indonesia. I was talking to Arti at that point in Magento, and she's really supporting the idea. Magento actually comes to Indonesia, and we held our first event in 2015. Our first event, it's like, it's only about 100 of us. It's very small, but we invite everybody from the player, competitors, payment ecosystems, shipping ecosystems, to so that they know what is Magento is and help them invest into the platform together. And we see a very good turnout. I mean, we never think that there's going to be that many people comes. And then that's just, we've just built upon them year after year. I think you were there in the second year. We have, it's already about 150 people or maybe 200 already at that point. And we just continue to grow that ecosystems. And then we see that's how it should work, basically.
So this is something distributors can learn from as well. As you know, a lot of distributors in the US are a part of large associations, trade associations. Mm-hmm. They compete with each other, and there are also opportunities for distributors to partner together. It's not just about competition. You know, we can also learn from each other. I'm also curious to know about the B2B market in Indonesia or the distribution market in Indonesia.
Yeah, it's still very traditional. That's one of the things that at Sirclo, we actually try to influence a lot of our principal to have a mindset change, right? Maybe a real story that we have is like we're working with Unilever right now. Obviously, we help them to sell all the Unilever products through the online. And we've obviously, initially, it's the easiest way is just having all the items in our warehouse, right? But that's not going to be efficient. You know, the challenge of e-commerce is always logistics is one of the biggest challenges. If it's everything has to be shipped from our warehouse, it's going to be very expensive and it's not going to be scaling. And there's no way that we will replace all the distributor existing of Unilever as well, right? It just doesn't make sense. I mean, they have built this network of distributor for a long time. I think more than 10 years, maybe, or 20 years even, right? And it's already established. So why do we have to recreate again something? I mean, just the cost, the time, it just doesn't make sense. So we could try to convince the principal, in this case, Unilever, basically, hey, let's work together. And then let's call out all the distributor that willing to join, basically. And we make sure we provide the technology. We let the distributor to connect to us so that now, actually, we are piloting already with a few distributor, and we're very happy with to collaborate together. So the online sale that happened on Unilever, we be able to leverage the what we call the local distributor closer to wherever the customers that buy the items. So instead of coming from our warehouse, we just collaborate directly with the distributor to ship the items to them. So I think that's the way to go with Indonesia, right? Because that's how we're gonna able to tackle the whole archipelago problem. And at the end of the day, the goods has to be really close to the customers. There has to be efficient. I mean, shipping is, customer doesn't want to pay shipping beyond, like, if they can just walk the next street buying the items, why do they have to pay the expensive shipping just to get items? It doesn't make sense, right? So for the speed and for the efficiency and the cost, obviously, it would be better to leveraging the existing ecosystem, in this case, distributor or reseller, into the business.
Unilever is a big name, and you also work with a lot of big names in Indonesia. How do you acquire a customer like Unilever? Give us some sales advice.
Well, I mean, typically they found us, I will say. I mean, for Unilever, I have to credit to all my colleagues, my COO and my CEO that have a relationship early with them. My CEO has actually come from a PNG as well, so he has a lot of connection in that space. But even for us in the IQ, for a lot of the retail just find us. So we, through the referral, a lot of friends refer to friends in the business. So it's, even though it's huge Indonesia, but it's a very close-knit industry as well, right? So yeah, I mean, yeah, we're happy to work with a lot of this great guy.
Yeah, it's always easier when they come to you rather than you trying to reach out to them. Muliadi. So let's say, you know, there's a company out there looking to do business in Indonesia. Can you tell us three things that they need to know about Indonesia to do business there?
Well, let's talk about the Indonesian people in general. Right? I think obviously in Indonesia, you experience already coming to Indonesia. They're all very friendly. They're very social. They like to gather together, eat together and stuff like that. But this also have a very bad side effect, which is they're very hard to say no and very hesitant to do that. So come with balance. But doing business here, though, I think the most important is to understand market here. It will be better to work with some local partner in here, because I think you have to navigate a lot of the uncertainty in Indonesia, right? I think it's much better. I think I would say in the last 10 years that I'm here, it's a lot of improvement. I mean, from the government structure, regulations, but it's still a lot of movement that it would be better to have a local partner to navigate together, especially to tackling a lot of those logistic issues and stuff like that. But it's a very growing it's very dynamic economically. It's opportunities there, but expectation has to be right. We are still economy-wise, we're not as high as India. So you have to adjust in with all those factor in. So like I said, when I started that company, I have to see what is the value translate into the local as far as like what the company can afford and things like that, right? So a lot of like, I see a lot of foreign company come to Indonesia, they just say, okay, this is the price. We do this globally. This is the same. It's not going to work, right? And especially in the e-commerce technology, where when you're in the States, our average order value in the e-commerce is only 1/10 of whatever it is in the States. So everything has to be adjusted that way. So yeah, that's always my recommendation, is to always try to understand, adapt into the value and how things work here and go. And if you do that, then you can get like huge market rather than doing small.
Oh, definitely.
So yeah, that's the...
Find a local partner. That's a great advice. And also a lot of clothes we wear come from Indonesia, right? So you guys have a great export market as well. So Muliadi, the theme of this podcast is driven. And you are a very driven person. You travel the world, you work hard, you are aggressive. How are you driven? And for people out there who are not so driven or who really want to be driven, what advice would you give them?
Yeah, I will always love Simon Sinek. I think he always put it very nicely, saying you have to know why you do things, right? So I think that's what always been my driver. I mean, I've been in the e-commerce industry so long now, but I never at one any point is a feeling that this is bored or this is over, right? I mean, because there's always new things that drive you able to. When I came back from States here, I mean, I thought that I have everything, I know everything, but then there's everything change, right? I mean, the way it works, e-commerce works, is very different. So that those little things keep me able to learn stuff and drive me to excel myself in this space and continue to learn that way. It's very dynamic. I mean, now we're facing a lot of this changing in the customer behavior with all these younger generations. Retails have a different challenges. I mean, when we came back 10 years ago, we only have to deal with the mobile first. Now we're talking about video content driven, TikTok short videos, stuff like that, right? So there's always exciting things in our space in e-commerce. I think that's what make me very much excited every day working in this space. At least until now, this is still something that it's always being my passion in there.
And what advice would you give for somebody who wants to be driven, right? But then, hey, sometimes you procrastinate. So what do you
Well, I mean, you always have to come back to knowing that why you do stuff, right? I mean, I think when you have that gives you that strength to push through. A lot of stuff, I mean, obviously procrastinate something that's always haunt us. But things like, and when you know what you want, the why, then it gives you that push, right? I mean, we never think when we want to come back to Indonesia, it's take us 3 years to come back. But then, yes, I come back to that driven again, that will push us to take that steps, and don't be afraid to take that steps, right? If you exactly know. I mean, the dangers is like if you don't know what you want, and then that's become very, very, very hard.
Oh, that's great. Start with why and always get out of your comfort zone. So just reflecting back on your career, is there anything you would have done differently, you think? Or what is something you've learned from your failures?
Yeah, I don't think I would do anything differently. I personally believe that everything that we've been through has been very educating and making a big impact on whatever the next decision I do. Right? I'm such lucky when I was back in the States, I worked with a couple of companies that I can directly learn from the owner of the company. So in some way, it almost feels like they are preparing me on that entrepreneur skills when I need it when I came back to Indonesia. So I work with quite a few. Leon Shonik is my first boss in Atlanta Solutions when I was still in consulting. I mean, he's the owner and he's the mentor. And then back in guidance, I learned a lot from John Provisor, also another awesome mentor for me, how he moved his career owning guidance as part of the partner in guidance. So those steps has been really preparing to where I am right now, right? So I there's nothing that we should regret. I think every experience, we just have to embrace it and learn from that. And that's what makes you able to do better.
And you are a gadget geek. So what gadget are you working on right now? And what's the gadget you're recently obsessed with?
Yes, I bring these gadgets from Japan in the past. I do business on bringing all those micro computers, small computer. Obviously, now it's become phones. I still following very, very closely that industry. What next in the mobile devices? I mean, obviously, I have this flip phone myself as my daily driver, beside all the Mac and then all the devices that I have here. But yeah, I love those because I see how much this gadgets, like, yeah. It's almost like foretelling what will be the people were doing with that. And because usually technology will make the changes on the social behavior. And then that's back to my passion on the retail. So I always try to connect the technology, the gadget that I love with that other passion as well. So I closely watching the Apple Vision Pro now. I don't know if that's so practical yet. I haven't made my decision to buy it yet for Indonesia. Maybe it's a little bit far-fetched. I have Meta Quest 2 sitting in my living room that I never use. But I think AR, VR is definitely something to, as I've been closely monitoring the last couple of years and see how practical that will be and impacting us.
So you travel a lot. What's the most fun trip you've ever done? Or the most exciting place you've ever been to?
Well, I love to eat. So I love, there's always a few countries that I really enjoy going to back and back again. Hong Kong is one of it where I grow there. But one of the things about the Hong Kong is it's very vibrant. It's been a while, it didn't came back, but the Hong Kong has been like very vibrant, a lot of like a cultural mix with the good food and enjoying the closeness in that city. And it's very like, I have a lot of bucket lists. I definitely want to try out a lot of the Latin America, Spain, those places. But we have the chance to go to Italy during the before pandemic on the Mid Magenta. I really love the city. Me and my wife really love it. I think it's just really great to be there in the middle of this historical city, all the historical buildings. And it's really enjoy walking around that in Rome and as well as in Venice. So, and we actually take the chance to rent a car and then drive to the small city near Venice.
Travel is a privilege and definitely teaches you a lot of things. So Muliadi, we interview a lot of leaders. And what's a question you would like to ask the next person we interview?
What question do you, okay, I think how, because you interview a lot of leader, right? I mean, how can, there's sometimes in the leader, we feel like there's like, we are have nobody or it's around us. Like, how can we keep ourselves to be always not feeling lonely as in that leader space, right? What do they do typically to do that?
That's a great question. We'll make sure to add it in when we so Muliadi, I would like to end with this question. We usually end with this question. What book are you reading right now?
All right. So exactly, I just bought in a few weeks ago, there's a book called Filter World. I just started reading it. It's basically, it's about how we're living in the world where everything's algorithms and it's basically flattened the culture. The title is very intriguing. So I bought it. I just read a few chapters. But there's always a few books that I always keep reading. I mentioned about Simon Sinek. I continue to always, time to time, come back to that book and read again and read again and read again. There's a few books of that. And then obviously the Built to Last, that's one of my favorite books that I've been reading 3 times now in the last 2 years. So yeah.
No, that's a great recommendation. And I've read Simon Sinek's Start With Why. I think that's a great read as well. And you talk about why, right? So why are you really doing it? And that's a great read. So let me, this is the book I am reading right now, actually. So it's actually a Tamil book. I'm just trying to get, it's the language I speak. So this is written by a great poet. His name is Kannadasan. So it talks about Hinduism and, it's about 10 volumes, but very small. So I'm kind of excited reading that, so.
Very nice.
Muliadi, I mean, it's been a lot of fun chatting with you as always. Thanks for inspiring us. And I think you're also a great example of long-term thinking, because a lot of people really expect results. Hey, I want to do this today. And I want to build a big company tomorrow. But that really doesn't work. Like you said, your story is a great example of long-term thinking. You start small and then you keep building on it. And, it's a journey. So thanks for inspiring us. And thanks for joining the DCKAP's Driven podcast. And one more thing, if you have not subscribed to our Driven podcast, please click the subscribe button. And Muliadi, I would also ask you to subscribe to our Driven podcast. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you, Karthik.
Thanks for joining us on this episode of the Driven podcast. Check out our other episodes for more and subscribe. to be the first to access every new episode.